to generate torque or the motor force. So because of that, this force will be the Lagrangian force, which is the force exerted by a structure on the fluid, will be decomposed into three. Elastic force, which consider stretching and compression, bending force, and motor force or the torque. Now these forces are computed by using a function called E, capital E, which is known as variational derivative of elastic energy function. So this is basically from stress and strain energy theory from solid mechanics. And once we compute the force, this Lagrangian force, this will be interpolated with the help of a Dirac delta function, delta x minus x, with the neighboring fluid grid points. So surrounding with the structure, there will be fluid grid points. So the structure will be divided into a number of grid points. So at every grid point, there will be force acting. So these forces will be interpolated towards the surrounding neighboring Eulerian grid points. And then we solve the Navier-Stokes equation. And you know that when you solve the Navier-Stokes equation, you will get velocity and pressure. So we'll get fluid velocity. And using the same Dirac delta function, this fluid velocity will be interpolated towards the structural points, structural boundary points. So we can compute the velocity of the structure, capital U. And once we know the velocity of the structure, because the structure is moving, we can find the new position of the structure by using a simple Euler exploration scheme. So this is the way, this is the structure by which an immersed boundary method algorithm works. And in my study, I use fractional step-based finite volume method. So fractional step basically means how I solve this Navier-Stokes equation. There are many schemes. So fractional step is one such scheme where the time is decomposed into three steps. And we use a staggered Cartesian grid system. So what is meant by staggered Cartesian grid system is that the velocity and pressure, they are defined at different location of the cell, not at the grid points. The advantage of that, we can easily satisfy the continuity throughout the problem. Okay, so with this perspective, now I'm going towards the simulation part. So to address the bacterial motility problem, so what I initially did, I understand that the helical flagellum plays the key role in the motility. So the helical flagellum has a helical shape. So the shape is a bit complicated and there are a lot of biological things involved. So I just bring the problem into a simple problem where I consider that the flagellum is an elastic rod, a straight rod. And I use a concept that I connected a motor to the rod. And I just want to see that when the motor rotates, how the elastic rod behaves. So we all know how a rigid rod behaves. If it is kept in a fluid, it will simply rotate. But in case of elastic rod, and under low Reynolds number, the phenomena is completely different. So the background is to understand the fluid structure interaction of an elastic filament or elastic rod with a viscous fluid, and to explore the interplay of mechanical and hydrodynamic aspects of the elastic rod motion in Stokes' law, because it's a low Reynolds number problem, relevant to micro and nano length scale. Because even though I consider an elastic rod, the dimensions of this rod are basically taken from that of a bacteria. So only difference is that instead of helical rod, I consider a straight rod. The main motivation of this study was, there was a model developed by another research groups, Lim and Peskins, for a real bacteria, where the model was highly complicated. And they did the simulations using another version of immersed boundary method, discrete elastic rod theory based immersed boundary method. And they reported that to simulate such a problem, the CPU time required is in a high performance computer is 43 days. Which was very quite challenging. So inspired from this, my aim was to address the same problem and to bring a simplified model and capture the same physics in a shorter time. So what I proposed was I make the structure or the model very simplified one. I use lesser number of elastic links, and they have considered many elastic ring as a part of the motor, the biological motor. So I just consider only one one part as the biological motor, and computational effort is reduced. So at the end, I will tell you how much time I took to simulate the same problem. And the elastic road is modeled with a network of elastic links, whereas the fluid is described by continuity and momentum equations. So the idea, the main objective of this study is to capture the dynamic behavior of the road under different rotational frequency of the motor. So this is the domain, this is a three-dimensional problem. So what I am going to do here, what I did here is I developed a computational model using immersive boundary method, where I wrote a code using Intel Visual Fortran. So I have not used any commercial software to explore this problem. Everything is done with the help of writing a code. So I developed a three-dimensional computational code, and where you have a 3D domain, there is a viscous fluid inside the domain. The fluid is stationary. And I consider an elastic road. The road is divided into a number of circular cross sections. And between these circular cross sections, it is divided into again number of points, which is called immersive boundary points. And I constructed a lot of elastic links between these points. Now, if we see this figure, the 2D figure, you can see that I didn't consider a straight road. I just give a slight bend at the free end. So the first end is fixed, and I attached a motor here. So there is first cross section is considered as the biological motor. So why I consider a bend at the free end means if it is straight, there is nothing will happen. It is under equilibrium. So even if you give I rotational frequency, it will simply rotate as a straight route. So because of that, I gave a perturbation. I gave a slight bend or tilt, so that whether it can come back to its original equilibrium straight position or whether it breaks that position. And that is the physics behind bacterial propagation. Now you can see that the different type of links I created. I created cross-sectional links, that is links between immersive boundary points on the same cross-section, same circular cross-section. I constructed longitudinal links between two circular cross-sections, straight links. I considered diagonal links between cross-sections diagonally. So why I considered all these links is because to enforce flexibility or elasticity to the structure. And all these links will have a stiffness constant, elastic constant. So by controlling the value of this stiffness constant, I can make this structure rigid, highly elastic, semi-elastic, etc. So that is the biggest advantage of this model. And since it's a low Reynolds number problem, I removed the convection term from here, inertia term from here. So my equation will simplify it into a pressure term and a viscous term and the Eulerian force F. And the Eulerian force will be computed from the Lagrangian force, which has two parts here. One is due to the elasticity. That means the road can undergo stretching and compression. Bending is not considered here. And since I attached a motor to the first cross section, there will be a torque or the motor rotation. So I have to compute a motor force. So this, because the fluid is stationary, so the fluid motion will be initiated by the motion of the structure. So I am initiating a motion to the structure by giving a rotation to the first cross-section. And this rotation, this movement will be propagated towards the neighboring cross-sections with the help of the elastic links. So this is the way it works. And this is the way I computed elastic force. So if you see this equation, this is nothing but Hooke's law for an elastic spring. So there will be, it's like in a simple sense, it's like there is the initial resting length, and then when I give a force, the resting length will change. So I just initiated a force, so there will be a change in resting length. And the motor force will be computed, is like we gave a rotation to the immersive boundary points. Because of that, it will rotate to some speed. But since that initial first cross section is considered to be stationary, means it will not move in the x and y direction, it only will rotate. So every time I had to apply a force and bring back to the original position, but it will be rotating. So we use a force which is called tether force, in which we will have a motor instant position, which is stationary, and you will get a motor target position, which is the new position obtained by the movement of the rotation of the motor. So this is a rotational matrix which I imposed to find the motor force. Then using a direct delta function, I compute the Eulerian force. And this is the direct three-dimensional direct delta function I used. And I use a semi-implicit fractional step-based finite volume method where Krang-Nicholson scheme is used to discretize the viscous term. And since it is a fractional step method, I use a pseudo pressure term, a pressure correction term. So I will first find an intermediate pressure, and with that I will satisfy the continuity, and then using that I will compute the fluid velocity and fluid pressure. And then I will, that will be an intermediate fluid velocity. So using that intermediate fluid velocity, I will correct the pressure field, and using the corrected pressure field, I will find the actual velocity. So that comes under semi-implicit fractional step algorithm. Once I compute the fluid velocity, I will compute the Lagrangian velocity, the velocity of the structure, that means velocity of the immersed boundary points, by same interpolation technique using the same delta delta function. And once I compute this new position, I can see this new velocity, I use Euler and explicit scheme so that I can find the new position of different points on the road. So this is the physical and computational parameter. So everything is done under non-dimensional scheme. So all my study are under dimensionless, so that the number of variables will be reduced. And whatever the results I generated, I can easily convert it into microscale. So a domain of 20 by 20 into 20 is considered. The grid size is 32 by 32 by 32. The road length is 10. Diameter is 1. And initial position is given. The stiffness constant is 1. So this stiffness constant is not arbitrary. It is the same stiffness constant as relevant to a bacterial flagellum, but it is non-dimensionalized. A time step of 0.1 is taken. So there are two motor frequencies considered. One is 0.001, another is 0.001. So one is low, other is high. Okay, now I'm going to show you the first results in animation, where I apply a low rotational frequency to the motor, which is attached at the first cross section. And there is the fluid surrounding it. The fluid is stationary. And what you can see that how this road will rotate. So you can see that the road will rotate, but it rotates and come to a straight position. And if I, even if I continue my simulation, nothing will happen. It will remain the straight position. That means it reaches a steady state equilibrium, mechanical equilibrium position. That means if the road rotates at low rotational frequency, it always comes under equilibrium, even though it is elastic. And if you see the surrounding flow field, always there will be a rotating flow field surrounding the road. And this flow field will help the structure, the road, to become straight. But the physics is different when we apply a higher rotational frequency. So I applied a 4 times higher than the previous value, and you can see what happens here. The road deforms continuously and it takes a helical shape, and finally it folds back to its motor. So you can see that it undergoes, I just captured 4 instantaneous picture, but during all this there are many type of shape conformation it changes, it goes. So finally what happens is it just fold back behind the motor cross section. And bacteria utilizes this concept. That means bacterial flagellum, they can rotate at very high rotational frequency and they can undergo a lot of shape changes. And because of that, it gets thrust and can move forward. So you can see that when we capture the flow field, that is very interesting. When it folds back, if you see this figure, there is a fluid. It is pushing the fluid in the upward direction. That means this concept, if you use in a microfluidic device, without the help of a pump, an external mechanism, I can use this concept to push the fluid, pump the fluid from one place to another without the need of a microfluidic pump. So in that way, this physics can be helpful in developing microfluidic devices. So obviously there exists a critical frequency, and through a series of numerical simulations, I found what is that critical frequency below which always the stable straight motion happens. So it is called Turling motion, and above which always the helical shape and this continuous shape deformation happens, which is called Overwhirling motion. And I computed what will be the critical frequency. So it was for this simulation, it was in between 0.002 and 0.0025. And as I mentioned that the previous work, which was similar to this, was reported 43 days of computational time to capture the same physics. I took only 7 days in an Intel i-Core i7 processor, even though the processor's capability was very low compared with the processor. But in 7 days, in 1 week time, the same physics has been explored with a simplified computational model. So that was the novelty in this work. So moving with this, I moved to the next problem where I directly simulated the propulsion behavior of a bacterial flagellum. So the straight road now has been converted into a helical flagellum. The numerical method is same, the methodology is same. So I won't stress more on the methodology until there is a difference. So as I mentioned, a bacterial cell is propelled by rotating helical shaped locomotive organs called flagella, which are driven by a tiny motor embedded in the cell body. And because of the rotation of the flagella filament, bacteria achieves the propulsion. And in case of monotrichous bacteria, the change in the direction of rotation of the bacterial motion, counterclockwise or clockwise, can make the bacteria to move forward or backward. And this hydrodynamics of flagellated bacteria in viscous fluid is a key concept in the field of microfluidics. A bacterial motor can serve as a fluid actuator to create in a microfluidic network to accomplish useful. It's a novel technique. And because of this, we are addressing the problem of understanding the bacterial propulsion. So the main objective of this study is to develop a three-dimensional boundary method for a helical flagellum of a monotrichous bacterium. And in this case, the bacterium is driven by an external torque. So the previous case, the road was not moving in the forward direction. Its movement was restricted. But in this case, the flagellum is allowed to move. So we can capture the propulsion. So there a motor force was applied, a motor rotation was applied. So here I will be applying a torque. So we will be capturing the flagellum motion under various conditions. We'll be capturing the flow field. Then this is the flagellum motion. This is the helical flagellum. So we consider, so here the main difference is that in the previous study I considered a circular cross section. But to reduce the computational effort, I went for a triangular cross section. So the results remain the same, but I can reduce computational effort. So I consider a triangle, and there are three IMS boundary points. And same like the previous, the first cross section is considered as the flagellum motor. The shape is helical here. And the shape given for the flagellum is an arc tangent envelope, which is the normal shape for a helical flagellum. So the bacteria which I considered was a monotrichous bacterium, whose name is Vibrio alginolitis. So same like previous case, I constructed three type of links, cross-sectional links, longitudinal links, and diagonal links. So you can see that how these links are formed, and each link will have a stiffness constant. So I given different stiffness constant for the links, and so that there will be a flexibility. It can work as an elastic structure. And the computation of elastic force remains the same. So here only difference is that the computational motor force, because in this case, since then torque is applied, we will be computing the motor force based on a torque. So the torque will be applied at the center of the triangular cross section. So from that, I can compute what is the force acted at the three IB points on the first cross section. So remember that the force is applied, motor force is applied only on the first cross section. And to initiate the motion, the fluid surrounding the structure is initially stationary. It starts moving only because of the flagellum motion. So the force which is applied at the first cross section will be transferred to the neighboring cross section with the help of elastic links. So we use the same direct delta, we use a different direct delta function here. And this is the computational domain. So the domain is 4 by, this is a three-dimensional problem. So 4 × 1 × 1 is the domain. We consider a flagellum of length 1.3 since it is helical in shape, which has a wavy nature, we consider three periods. The pitch of the flagellum is 0.24. The flagellum radius is 0.012. And through a series of simulations, we find the optimum stiffness constant for the longitudinal cross-sectional diagonal links, and which we use as 12.0. And the torque applied is 0.001, and a time step of 10 power minus 3 is used. Yeah. So first, I will show you how when I apply a torque for the first cross section of this flagellum, what happens? You can see that the flagellum is at 1.6 location, x location 1.6. It effectively swims in the forward direction by interacting with the surrounding fluid. So this was the initial position, and after some time of 400, it reaches here. And I computed the speed of the flagellum. So there are two speeds to be computed here. One is the forward speed, which is based on the first cross section. So we normally call it as the speed will be equivalent to the speed of the cell. So it is 1.3 into 10 power minus 4. It's a dimensionless value. So when we convert it into micro scale, it will be 13 micrometer per second. Similarly, I computed a UMF. UMF means mean flow velocity. It is the average velocity by considering all the cross sections and averaging over time and space. So it is around 9 micrometer. And as I mentioned that the bacteria's speed is in the range of 10 to 40 micrometer per second. So all these values comes under the same range. So in that way, the results are reliable. And I capture the flow behind the flagellum at different locations, from the left, from the first cross section, middle, the back cross section, etc. So every time, since the flagellum is rotating, there's always a rotating flow field surrounding the flagellum. And this, since you know that the fluid was stationary initially, when the flagellum rotates, it rotates the surrounding flow also. So when the surrounding flow rotates, by the rotation of the flagellum, it exerts force to the flagellum, which helps the flagellum to deform at the same time to move forward. So there is an interplay of both elasticity and hydrodynamics. Now, since the bacteria which I consider is Vibrio alginolitis, the Vibrio alginolitis has a can perform a swimming strategy. Like, it can move forward by rotating its flagellum in the counterclockwise direction, and it can itself change the direction to clockwise, and it can swim backward. So because of this, I just tried the same phenomena by simulations. So in this simulation, what I did, I just took a time. At the half of the time, I made the bacteria to move forward by applying a counterclockwise torque. And suddenly, I just changed the direction of the torque to clockwise. So I just want to see what will happen, whether it goes to instability or whether it can swim backward. So you can see that in the middle of the half of the computational time, the flagellum swims effectively in the forward direction. And when I change the direction to clockwise, the flagellum comes backward. It rotates in the clockwise direction and comes backward from that initial position. That means it can effectively perform forward to backward motion. So it's coming back. So that means the flagellum model which I developed is able to capture the same phenomena done by Vibrio alginolitis. So forward motion, it moves to this location, and in backward motion, it comes back behind this initial position. But the very interesting point here is that when I compute the forward and backward swimming speed, I found that the backward swimming speed is 4.5 times higher than the forward swimming speed. And in case of the original bacteria, Vibrio alginolitis, experimentally it is found that it is backward swimming speed is 1.8 times higher than the forward swimming speed. So this concept, when we use for a micro robot, so for example, in case of micro robot, our aim, target is to deliver something. For example, to deliver a drug at some location. So its actual purpose is in the forward motion. Now, after delivering the drug, it has to come back, and come back, it has nothing to do. So if it comes back with very high speed, then it is easy for, we can save a lot of time, we can save a lot of energy, we can save a lot of things, since its return is in a higher speed compared with its forward motion. So that is the novel thing when we use this concept for the development of a micro robot. So this is the case for a single flagellated bacterium, where it can perform forward motion, backward motion. And I did a lot of other simulations, which I'm not presenting here, to optimize the configuration of this flagellum, so that these results will be highly helpful for designing a bacterial robot. Now I move to the next topic, where I consider a multi-flagellated bacteria, which is called Escherichia coli bacteria, and where I want to see that whether I can capture the phenomenon of bundling and tumbling. Because in case of multi-flagellated bacteria, each flagellum has a tiny motor. Suppose there are two flagella, there will be two motor attached to the cell body. So when all the motor rotates in the direction of counterclockwise, bundling will happen, which pushes the cell forward. When one or all the motors rotates in the clock, changes the direction to clockwise, tumbling will happen. And this run and tumble will allow the bacteria to swim toward different directions, different orientations in viscous fluid. So the idea behind this computation is to capture this physics. So this is the computational model. So what I did, I just extended the model where I bring one more flagellum. But the difference here is that I did not apply the torque here. Instead, I apply a rotation to the first row section, because I don't want the flagellum to move forward. I'm not capturing the propulsion, but I want to see whether it can undergo bundling and tumbling. So the same model is extended, so there is nothing new here. Only thing is that there may be a situation in a computation that the flagellum can come very close. When they come very, very close, numerically, it is very challenging, because there will be numerical instability. So we call it as numerical crossing. When one flagellum touches the other, there will be a numerical crossing, and that can make your code diverging. To avoid that, what I did, I introduced a repulsive force into the domain. So what this repulsive force will do, I will define a threshold distance between these two flagellum. So I will set that the flagellum should not cross this distance. So when it reaches that distance, this repulsive force will act. Other than that, the force will remain as zero. So it will act and it will just repel the flagellum. But then I can find up to what distance it is coming closer. So that distance will be very, very less than its initial distance. So I can visualize that whether they are going for a bundle or not. So this is nothing with the physics. It is only for a numerical purpose. I just introduce a repulsive force. So this is the way the two flagellum of a single bacteria has been initially kept. So I kept an initial distance between the two flagellum, and both the flagellum will be rotating with the same speed in the same direction. That means counterclockwise direction. And let's see what happens. They interact each other, and you can see they form the bundle. So this is the last picture I captured at time t equal to 600. So you can see that it forms a very effective bundle. And if there is a head connected here, it can push the cell effectively in the forward direction. And I capture the flow field. So what is the interesting point here is that in the case of a single flagellated bacteria, when I capture the flow field and compare the flow field with a multi-flagellated bacterium, what I found that it is, for the multi-flagellated bacterium, it is two times stronger than for a single flagellated bacterium. That means if you are developing a micro robot with a two flagellum or multiple flagellum, it can move very fast compared with single flagellum. So now I use the same model and want to analyze that whether my model can capture the tumbling motion. So the flagellum remains the same, motor rotational frequency is the same. The only difference is that one flagellum will move in the counterclockwise direction the other flagellum will move in the clockwise direction. So there is a opposite in the direction of rotation. So let's see what happens. So you can see that they never bundle. They always separate each other. So that means, and if you see the flow field, you can see that it is completely erratic, completely irregular. There is no proper flow field, because for one flagellum, you have a counterclockwise flow field. For other flagellum, you will have a clockwise flow field. They interact and disturb, and that disturbs the flagellum. So they are never going to bundle together. So this made us to think that there should be an exact combination of the handedness. Handedness means left-handed or right-handed, and the direction of rotation, clockwise or counterclockwise, which can result into bundling or no bundling. So what I found that a left-handed flagellum, both rotating at counterclockwise rotation, can only lead to bundling. Or right-handed flagellum, both rotating at clockwise rotation, can only lead to bundling. All other combination will lead to tumbling. So this has to be very careful when we decide, when we design a micro robot, because if you want to have only bundling, only movement in the forward direction, we should consider same direction of rotation and same handedness, left-handed or right-handed. Now, as I mentioned that bacteria performs a motion in the fluid by alternately changing the direction of rotation. That means it perform bundle, it perform tumble. So it will not be always performing a straight line motion. It can move in any irregular or random erratic motion in the fluid. So that is bundling to tumbling motion. So I just want to see that whether my model can capture that. For that, I did a simulation in which first half of the simulation, I allow both the bacterial flagellum to rotate in the counterclockwise direction so that they form a bundle. And in between, after that particular time, I change the direction of rotation of the one of the flagellum to clockwise and see that the bundle unravels and form a tumbling motion. So you can see that they form a bundle first and suddenly it changes the direction and forms tumbling, leads to tumbling. So this is the first part of first half of the simulation, where I started from t equal to 0 and t equal to 600. I get a bundled flagella. And the second half, from 600 to 1100, you can see that the bundle unravels and always form a tumbling motion. And same like a backward to forward motion, the tumbling occurs faster than the bundle. Now, this is the last study related to bacteria, where what I did, I considered two different same bacteria, but two bacteria. That means I want to analyze the hydrodynamic interaction between two swimming bacteria. So instead of a single micro robot, if you have two micro robot in a domain, how they can, they will be helpful, they will be, whether they will be effective. That means instead of helping somebody, by a single person, if there are two people, whether it will be helpful or whether it will be a disturbance in that way. So everything remains the same. So only difference is that this is where is an extension of the first problem, where I introduce one more flagellum. Okay, and both the flagellum are the flagellum of the same bacteria, the Vibrio alginolytis bacteria. So here I consider torque. I apply torque, so both flagellum can move in the forward direction and see how they mutually interact and how they interact with the surrounding flow field. So the numerical scheme is same, so I just skip that. We'll go to the result part. Now here the main important thing is that how this flagellum has to be arranged, how this bacteria has to be arranged. So one such arrangement is side-by-side arrangement in which one flagellum is kept above the other and they are released from a fluid domain where the fluid is initially stationary, and see what happens. Both the flagellum swims in the forward direction effectively and they never come closer. They just swim as it is. Yeah. And when you compare the swimming speed of flagellum 1 and flagellum 2, you can see that they are almost comparable. There is no that much increase. But the interesting point is that when you compare the swimming speed of individual flagellum with a single flagellum case, you can see that there's a drastic increase in the swimming speed when there are two flagellum present. That means the presence of one flagellum will increase, enhance the swimming speed of the other flagellum. That means instead of having a single micro robot for some applications, if you have multiple robots, it can perform the duty, it can propel at very high speed. The second interest was to see that side-by-side distance. So I just offsetted the distance. That means instead of keeping just above, I just kept one behind the other. So I just offsetted the distance of the upward flagellum. So when I offset the distance, this is the case with the offset distance zero. That means both the flagellum are one above the other. This is the case when the upper flagellum is offsetted by a distance of 0.05. That means it is behind the down flagellum. And this is the case when it is offsetted by a distance of 0.1. It is further behind the down flagellum. So what is interesting here is that when you go for offsetting, the speed of the flagellum decreases. And also, the flagellum will swim in a not in a proper way. It basically undergoes an orientation type of motion. That means it cannot be effectively swim, as you can compare the diagram here. So that means offsetting will not help for better swimming. So we cannot do the offsetting in the side-by-side arrangement. The second arrangement, which normally used for micro robot applications, is called tandem arrangement, one behind the other. So we need to have a large domain where if you can keep one flagellum behind the other and just see how they can swim. So first I kept the one flagellum behind the other where the distance is very small, means they are very close. The second simulation I kept at far distance so that whether the initial separation distance has any effect. So for the first case, when they are very close, both the flagellum swims effectively in the forward direction. So I will compare the swimming speed. And second case, when the distance is kept little high, when they are far, in that case also they swim effectively in the forward direction. Yeah. So if you compare the speed of flagellum 1 and flagellum 2 when the separation distance is small, you can see that the speed of flagellum 1, this is flagellum 1, is higher than the speed of flagellum 2. That means when you have somebody behind, the front person, the front flagellum can swim with very high speed. This is because the backward flagellum will create a flow field behind that flagellum. So that will help the flagellum to move forward. There's pushing from that flow for the front flagellum. So that is very interesting. And when we increase the distance, still the front flagellum has a higher speed compared with the backward flagellum. But when it compare with the previous case, when the separation distance is very small, the speed is less. So here you can see that it is 3.07 and here it is 3.27. It is 2.16 and here it is 1.95. That is because if it is far, the interaction is less. So if you want to keep two flagellum in a tandem arrangement in a domain, for some applications, we have to keep them very close so that the front flagellum will move forward with high speed. And both the flagellum, when we compare with the single flagellum case, is having higher swimming speed. So that means if you go for multiple bacteria, multiple bacterial robot for a particular application is effective than a single bacterial robot. So with this, the first part of this talk is over. So where I introduce about bacteria, I introduce about bacterial flagellum motion, I introduce about bacterial bundling and tumbling, and then finally hydrodynamic interaction between two flagellum. And all these simulations are done with the help of immersed boundary method, where we develop three-dimensional computational models using immersed boundary finite volume method. A code is written with the help of Intel Visual Fortran, and all these simulations are done with the help of the code. This is an in-house code developed by me, and the result is this research is still going on. It is the continuation of this result was done as part of my DST project, where the study was still going on. Now, the second part of my talk is about sperm, the swimming of sperm, which is modeled as an organism in a viscous fluid. Now, compared with the previous problem, here things are very simplified because it is a two-dimensional study. So first, I will shed some light why this study is significant. As I mentioned, microfluidics finds immense applications in the area of sperm sorting and separations for infertility treatment. Sperm motility in presence of background flow is of practical relevance for successful fertilization, because the sperm interacts with the background flow of different magnitude and it moves towards the egg for successful fertilization. So dynamics of motile sperm in vivo is essential for natural fertility. And we are going to mimic the same thing for infertility treatment, for artificial fertility, using microfluidic based devices. They are called sperm sorter. So it is necessary to separate motile sperm from the non-motile or the dead ones for successful fertilization. So the knowledge on sperm propulsive dynamics under background flow can help in understanding the understand effectively how the motile sperm can be separated from the non-motile one in a microfluidic sperm sorter. So that is the key objective of this study. Further, microfluidic devices can be used to restrain sperm motility within a bounded surface, where the behavior is a result of interaction between sperm and the surface. That means it's basically known as sperm tracking, something like that. And another important thing is that the initial location of sperm when we want to separate has a very important role, because a sperm can swim in centerline fashion. It can swim in upstream and downstream fashion in a channel. So its swimming strategy is greatly governed by the initial position. Because if the flow is shear flow, you have a flow direction positive and negative above and below the center of the channel. So the initial location will have a significant impact in designing the final propulsive strategy. So we should know exactly in what direction the sperm swim, so that we can collect it or we can extract it from that location. And it is a very ongoing research, because mainly because of the sperm motility, the underlying effect of fluid flow in sperm motility is not clear to the research world. Now, from the fluid dynamics point of view, as I mentioned, it is a fluid structure interaction problem. Same like flagellum, sperm is also a structure which is elastic and flexible. Same like a flagellum, it has a head and a tail. So I do not consider a head, I consider only the tail part. And it is flexible, and the fluid dynamics is at low Reynolds number. So it's a Stokes flow. As I mentioned that the application of this research will be for developing motile human sperm sorting by an integrated microfluidic system, something like this, which is developed by some research group in Taiwan. So you can see that this is a microfluidic chip where the semen sperm samples will be supplied here, and in a laminar flow, a Poiseuille flow will be applied. And there are two types of sperm, I told motile and dead. So motile sperm will be collected effectively at this location, and dead sperm, which will be collected as a waste. So our aim should be to remove this dead one at the early stage, so that it won't interact with this motile one. If it interacts, its efficiency reduces. It cannot swim effectively. Because in infertility treatment, sperm count as well as sperm speed, efficiency of the sperm, both are important. So we should get efficient sperm for good infertility treatment. Yeah, so there are two types of study performed here. One, I put a sperm in a two-dimensional channel domain. So initially what I did, I made the flow to be stagnant. The fluid is not flowing. And the second study, what I consider a shear flow. And I just want to see that how it moves. So in case of shear flow, the upper and bottom wall will move at same speed in different direction. But in the case of non-flow, Initially, the fluid is stationary. Because of the sperm motion, the fluid starts moving. It is a two-dimensional problem where the sperm has been considered as a, because if you see the structure of the sperm, it's like a sine wave. So I consider a sine wave as a sperm, and like a one-dimensional elastic filament, and it has been divided into a number of IB points. So same Navier-Stokes equations are used. So here the main difference is like the way elastic energy function is computed. So here I consider bending. The sperm can undergo stretching, compression as well as bending. There is no motor here, but I give an external force to the sperm so that I just initiated a motion to the sperm. But the final motion and final shape of the sperm is decided by the hydrodynamic interaction. Yeah, same solver is used here. And we worked on a dimensionless computational domain. So I'll just directly go to the results. So first results were I studied the motion of the sperm in a channel when the surrounding fluid is not flowing initially. And first I kept the sperm in the center of the channel and just observe what happens. So the sperm swims in the forward direction effectively in a center line fashion. And I computed the mean speed. It was around 0.1783 dimensional speed. And then I kept the sperm in the very close to the top channel wall, very close to the top wall, and see what happens. So here the interesting phenomena is that the sperm swims towards the channel wall, not in a center line fashion. And when I compare the swimming speed when with the near top wall and center of the channel, there is a 30% increase in the swimming speed. That means a sperm can swim effectively with very high speed when it is very close to the channel wall, because the channel wall is at no slip condition, it is stationary. So this idea can be used when we want to extract the sperm. If you keep at the center, it always move in the center line fashion. But if you keep somewhere near the top wall where you want to extract, it can swim very high speed and it will swim towards that wall. So you can easily extract from there. And this is the flow field, which I captured. So you can see that there is always a rotating type flow behind the sperm. And that flow field is generated because of the sperm motion, which will help the sperm to deform, get a different shape. And also it helps the sperm to swim forward direction. Now I will move to the shear flow. So as I mentioned that the shear flow is initiated by moving the upper and bottom wall at the same speed with a different direction. So first I kept the sperm in the center line position. So under shear flow, even though it is at the center, it swims effectively in the forward direction with no disturbance. Yeah, so I captured the different position and computed the speed. It is around 0.09775. Now this is the flow field. So here you should remember that we have positive and negative flow field on the top and bottom, because here it is moving the forward direction, here it is moving the backward direction. But even though that is the case, the sperm can swim effectively because at the center, the velocity is zero. Now I consider two off-center position. One is above the center of the channel. So above the center of the channel, you will have a positive flow field. And let's see what happens. The sperm swims, but you can see that it is going back. So it cannot swim effectively. It is going back. That means there's a downward motion, or I can say a backward motion. So the organism or the sperm is not able to swim in the forward direction. It is rather pushed back by the fluid flow, and the organism performs a backward motion. That means if you keep the organism very close to the above the center where you have a positive flow field, it cannot swim. So we cannot separate it. So I kept another off-center position where I kept below the center of the channel. Below, you know that the flow is in the negative direction. So here you can see that it swims effectively in the forward direction. And you can see one more interesting phenomena. It is swimming towards the bottom channel wall with very high speed, so that it can be extracted from the bottom channel. So you can see that it reaches here. This is the initial position, so it reaches here. So the organism swims in the forward direction, but it performs a downward propulsion towards the bottom channel wall. And the swimming speed is 83% higher compared to the case of swimming in a center line fashion. That means initial location and direction of flow is crucial in deciding the sperm motility under shear flow in a channel. Yeah, so that is about this research. Now, we have 10 minutes time, so I'm going to the last topic, a numerical study of deformation and migration of RBC in fluid flow. So in this study, what I did, I considered red blood cell as an elastic capsule. So elastic capsule means it's a circular object, and elastic capsule is the simplest model of a cell, like a bacteria head or red blood cell. So the main idea behind this study is that I just want to know how a red blood cell or elastic capsule migrate and deform under an applied flow. So here the fluid is flowing, and in the previous two cases, for example, bacteria, I applied an external force for the bacteria to move. In case of sperm, I applied an external force for the sperm to start moving. But in case of, so they are actually active propulsion. But in this case, I didn't give any force to the capsule, to the RBC. So they just deform and migrate. It is not swimming, it is just migration in the fluid flow. So we call it as it's a passive mechanism. But the capsule is elastic. There is a fluid inside and outside the capsule. That fluid will be different, but the densities are comparable. So I am using the same numerical scheme. Only difference is that the cross section is circular. So I will directly go to the model. So this is the case. So I use a parabolic velocity profile. It's a plane Poiseuille flow. I kept the at different location, at a particular location of the capsule here. And I just want to see how it moves and what is the shape obtained during its migration. Yeah, same numerical scheme is used. So there may be some slight changes depending upon the cross section. Yeah. So first results, you can see that I kept the capsule at different Y location. The channel is having a height of 2. So X location is fixed. I kept a different channel height location like 0.25, 0.35, 0.95 and 1. 1 means at the center. So what you can see that when channel location changes, means initial position changes, its shape is also changing. This is for a fixed Reynolds number of 40. So initial shape is circular. So it undergoes different shape because of the hydrodynamic interaction between the fluid. And I compare the shape with another research result. So they are pretty comparable. So it means initial location has a very key role in determining the final shape as well as position of the capsule. And this is for the case of another initial location. So you can see that the shape are comparable. And the previous results were for a center line position where I keep the capsule at the center. That means if you keep the capsule at the center, you are getting a shape like this. But if you keep the capsule at an off-center position, means below the center line position, your shape is completely different. That means initial position and as well as Reynolds number both have a key role in the final shape. And stiffness. As I mentioned that it is an elastic capsule. So if I just change the elasticity, the stiffness constant, and the shape deformation is different. So you can see that when the stiffness constant is reduced to 100 from 10,000, it deforms considerably. And this is the simulation results for different Reynolds number. So you can see that for Reynolds number 100 and 1.0, the deformation is very large. That means for low Reynolds number case, where the viscous effects are more dominant, the capsule deforms to a large extent. That means viscosity effects will result into the greater deformation of the capsule. And these results are basically shown for qualitatively, where just by observing the shape and initial position, one can see that whether it is deforming or not. So only capsule which are sick can deform like this. For example, if it is a healthy capsule or healthy red blood cell, the deformation will not be this much. It will be more stiff. So that's where we use this concept. So what I want to say is that quantitatively also we can determine this. For that, we introduce a parameter called Taylor deformation parameter, which define like this, where we have two length, L and LB. They are the maximum and minimum diameters passing through the center of the elongated capsule. So initially the capsule is stationary, circle. And after some time, it gets different shape. So if I compute the maximum diameter and minimum diameter passing through the center and find a ratio like this, is known as Taylor deformation parameter. And I can find the Taylor deformation parameter because after some time it becomes steady. And if I compare those value for different Reynolds number and different initial locations, I can say that how much it deforms. So you can see that for Reynolds number 10 and 40, the deformation for 10 is 0.046 and for 40 is 0.041. That means for low Reynolds number, deformation is more. Similarly, the study is extended for other Reynolds number, like for different locations. So you can see that for low Reynolds number and off-center positions, it deforms to a large extent. Yeah, this is for different initial location. Yeah, so with this, I would like to conclude. And the conclusion of this talk is computational models like inverse boundary method can be effectively used to study biofluid dynamics problem, which has relevance in mechanical engineering, in fluid dynamics, and which can develop microfluidic devices for the field of biomedical engineering. And computational CFD development will be highly helpful for experimentalists as well as researchers to develop such devices. So these simulation results will be helpful for developing or optimizing the geometry as well as the design. So in that way, they are highly relevant in the field of biomedical engineering. Thank you.
Ranjit sir?
Yeah.
Participants, if you have any questions, please ask. Please type in chat box.
Hello, I'm Dr. Barai here.
Yes, sir.
I have a question. Before that, I just want to give my background. I'm basically an aeronautical engineer.
Okay.
Professor in Jain University, Bangalore.
Okay.
And I also work on solid fluid interaction problem.
Okay.
Your study is excellent.
Yeah.
But some points are missing on explanation of solid fluid interaction.
Yeah.
So basically, you have to consider unsteady motion flow as well as unsteady motion of or vibratory motion of flagella, what you are talking about.
Yeah.
If you include those things, it will be pretty excellent, because many of the computational fluid dynamics studies you can avoid if you already know that they are the kind of results you expect out of unsteady motion around an elastic body. So when I'll give you a, can you see my paper here? Sorry. I'll just.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, can you see my paper here? Hello?
Yeah.
Yeah, so what happens, suppose if you have a steady motion and if you see flow field is before the body, it's uniform, and after body, you'll find that there is a loss in momentum.
Yeah.
Okay, now if you consider unsteady motion,
yeah,
then you'll have some kind of, you know, jet is coming out. Okay?
Okay.
So in steady flow, we talk about lift and drag.
Yeah.
But when you talk about unsteady flow, we don't talk about drag.
Yeah.
We talk about lift and thrust.
Yeah.
So you have to give explanation of your all this bacterial motion in terms of thrust. So where from this thrust is coming? So there actually solid fluid interaction comes. So to have solid fluid interaction and you can some kind of combined effect, you have to apply all three laws of Newton's. So that will give you better explanation in understanding physics of the problem.
Okay.
So what is happening? First, if you apply first law, that you have to have some motion. If you have to have some kind of force, then you have motion. Okay. Second thing is transfer of momentum. So when some body is oscillating in a flow, it transfers momentum to the fluid. And in turn, fluid provides some kind of reaction. And that produces thrust, drag, whatever forces we get in a moving object. Okay. In case of air, we have thrust force, drag force, lift force. Of course, similar kind of thing you'll have in highly viscous fluid also. So there's a whole lot of unsteady bound layer, or then you have laminar to turbulent separation and all. So there is another important topic in your study is separation. That's not really happen in case of living being, or you say birds and aquatic animal, or the virus and germs, what you're talking about, they don't have this kind of flow separation. So that's why they don't produce drag. If you consider a submarine, an equal size of shark, submarine required 8 times more power than submarine. Okay, it's because of, you know, bound layer separation and all those things. And similar thing happened for birds also. They eat only so much and they fly for thousands of kilometers. How it is possible? Because they efficiently propel themselves. Similar kind of thing happen in biological system also. Like they propel in such a way that they don't waste energy. But if we design something like that, what you are talking about robot, it wastes enormous amount of energy to overcome drag. Okay. So there are many interesting studies in this kind of fluid flow. No, my intention is that your study is good and excellent. But thing is that if you bring in those things, some well-known results or explanation can be fit into your study, and it will be much more effective in giving explanation to some people or designing a robot. Okay.
Okay.
That's all I wanted to tell. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you.
Rindu sir, one more question is there.
Yeah.
Does this study need validation?
Yeah. These study all are validated, but I have not included in the slides. For example, for the elastic road motion, it is validated against the results of the previous model, which was developed by another research group. And for bacterial motion, we validated with the experimental results, where the swimming speed was compared with the experimental values of all those bacteria. For sperm motion, it was compared again with the swimming speed and the shape, the deformation. And it was again compared with the very fundamental problem of infinite swimming of infinite sheet, Taylor sheet. And elastic capsule, it was compared with even shape as well as quantitatively and qualitatively. But I have not included this validation part in the presentation. But if you can refer my paper related to these topics, you can find the validation and details.
Fine, sir. Any questions, participants? Okay, over to Abhoka, sir.
Thank you, Professor Ranjit.
Yes,
had done a very good presentation, delivering a session in this program. So I thank the remarks made, appreciate and thank the remarks by Dr. Amilesh. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
And also thank all the participants. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for the opportunity. Thank you all.
Okay. Thank you, Ranjit, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Can I leave?
Your certificate.
Sir, I will mail your e-certificate today itself. Thank you.
Oh, okay, fine. Okay, sir. Okay. Thank you very much for a wonderful session. Thank you.
Thank you.